Hi, I'm Craig and welcome to my workshop. In this episode, I'm going to share everything I know about a simple tool called the Machinist Jack. Before we get into that though, I want to share a bit of brief backstory explaining how this episode came about. At the end of 2018, I was lucky enough to be in Emma and John's YouTube Machinists Secret Santa group. And my gift recipient was Darren in the UK, and I made him this bench block. Now, this was before I was making videos, so you'll have to make do with a couple of photos. And I was the gift recipient for a guy in the UK called Al. He runs a channel called Adventures with a Very Small Lathe. You've probably heard of him. And he made me this beautiful little machinist jack. And it's had a surprising amount of use in the last couple of years. This is the first machinist jack I've owned, and it's been very handy. Now, Al did get in touch with me recently. He had filmed the making of this machinist jack, but he hadn't edited the footage together yet. And he asked me if I'd be interested in doing a collaboration. So he's made the making of video, and I'm making the how-to video. And here's a short clip from Al himself.
If you're interested in learning how this tool was made, I've made a complete build video over on Adventures with a Very Small Lathe. It's my second attempt at this tool, and I've made the CAD model and material suggestions available if you're inspired to make one too.
I've left a link in the corner up there and below in the description to the video that Al mentioned. And I just wanted to add, if you haven't seen Al's channel, it's a pleasure. It's a fantastic channel with great video, clear audio, and very much worth watching. You're missing out if you're not checking him out. Now let's get on with the show. Here's the main problem that everyone's seen before. You've got a part in the mill vise and it's overhanging and flexing, and you want to hold it still so that it doesn't deflect and chatter. So the answer is to prop a machinist jack underneath and give the workpiece a bit of support. But tip number one is to always use a dial indicator. Zero it out before adding the jack, and this helps make sure that you're adding support without bending the work. And this makes for a much more accurate job. Tip number two is to clamp the workpiece down as well. If you are side milling, this is especially important. If you look at this geometry of an end mill, when it's cutting on the side, it does a shearing action, which is trying to lift the workpiece. And clamping from the top and holding the workpiece down, as well as giving it support from below, makes for a much better result. You get a much better finish. Now you might be thinking, isn't that machinist jack a little bit small for that mill? Well, I had a mini mill at the time when I got the jack, and the big mill came later. When I got the big mill, I wondered if I'd need a bigger jack, but it turns out no. With enough 1-2-3 blocks, you can make the jack any size you like. Now this is a sign bar, not a real one, just a model, and these are some gauge blocks. And with a sine bar, you can make an exact angle if you use the right height stack of gauge blocks. Now, if like me, you don't have a set of gauge blocks, one of your options is to use a micrometer and set your machinist jack to the right height. You've probably heard before that you shouldn't clamp parts in the side of the vise. You can rack the jaws and cause problems for the vise that way. And you end up with a point load on the part, and you end up with a part that moves. So that's no good. So you need to find a spacer for the other side of the vise so that the vise is being pulled down parallel. Now it's very rare that you've got the right size piece on hand, so it's very handy to use a machinist jack to act as that spacer. So I think this is the fifth tip. Basically, you want to nip the workpiece down. Let's say the workpiece is on the right, nip it down. Expand the jack until it just nips on the left, and then crank the vise tight. And you can test the workpiece, and if it's pivoting, you can expand or contract the jack, and that works well. Sometimes you'll find that your jack is rolling around in the vise, especially if you're using a bandsaw vise or a bench vise or something else. You can very easily make a little wooden V-block using a bandsaw. It takes 20 seconds, and that will hold your vise steady, and you won't have a problem. So that's tip 5B. And 5C is, sometimes the machinist jack will be too big to clamp something narrow in the vise, so use a spacer on the workpiece side. And here's me using a 1-2-3 block to demonstrate that. We looked at using a sine bar earlier, but if you don't have a sine bar, you have other options. This is a digital angle block, and you've probably seen a lot of people use these, and they're great for setting a workpiece at an angle. But I find they're hard to set precisely. Tip number six is to put the machinist jack underneath the end of the workpiece, put the ball bearing on the top so that you can get an angular contact, and adjust it very easily to a precise number. Tip number seven is for people with a rotary table on their mill. Now, as far as I'm concerned, a rotary table is crucial for a mill. Not having one is like not having an arm, and I use mine all the time. So the thing is, my rotary table didn't come with a tailstock, and I haven't bought one yet. And if you're doing an indexing job, where you're not rotating the workpiece as you cut, you can get away with using a machinist jack to support the end of a piece of stock. As you can see, it's sometimes difficult to get a V-block or a set of 1-2-3 blocks or anything else to fit and to work well. But with a machinist jack, with its adjustable height, you can always get a fit, and it always gives you really solid support. Again, if you can, use a clamp. It really depends on the milling operation that you're doing. Tip number eight is to use a larger version of these jacks to lift up an entire city. In the middle of the 1800s, Chicago had a problem with water drainage and disease spreading and all this kind of stuff. And what was needed was to pick up the city to build a sewage system underneath. So some clever engineers were paid with public and private money, and they raised most of Chicago by a meter or two, which I find incredible. Now, sometimes you want to measure how flat a surface is before you machine or grind or scrape or whatever. So you might have a rough casting or an unmachined piece of material. And tip number nine is use a jack, or ideally three of them, to tweak out the average level of the surface. There's a couple of ways of going about this. If your flat surface is set up level, you can use an engineer's level to align the new surface on top. You can see on the left end of my level here that my plate isn't truly level. So I'm going to use a different method. We'll call this tip 9B. I would use a DTI on a base, and I would tweak it into parallel at each end. Basically, I'd set it to zero and set the other end to zero using the jack, and then use the DTI to slide along and map out the high and low points. Tip number 10 is to support your parting tool. People with a smaller lathe often have problems with a flexible bed or very small contact area in the compound slide, or wear, or any number of things. And that weak link at the top of the tool post, between the tool post and the compound slide, is generally the least rigid part of the lathe. So add some support directly below it. Put the machinist jack underneath your cutting tool, connect it to the cross slide, and you've got a rigid setup there. You can part with much more confidence if you do this. This is a bonus tip, so we'll call this number 11. Make your own jack. I've shown a picture here of some coupling nuts, which is a very simple way to do it. You can face the ends of the bolts off so they're flat, or you can add a slight conical feature to the end, which helps you develop a point load or a point support on a casting or an angled piece. And it really doesn't need to take more than 5 minutes, and you'll use it all the time. I think it's worth making a nice one though, so I recommend you follow the link up here, or the link below, that goes to Alistair's video, and have a look at the method he's used. He's used some nice ground stock to make this one, and he's done a wonderful job. I'm just going to show you, as a final extra, a page from a book that I've got called Jigs and Fixtures. And this shows you several more different historical designs for screw jacks, machinist jacks. And these can be used in repeated operations or specific fixtures for specific jobs. But there's some ideas here that if you're interested in making something a little bit different, there's a lot on this page that can give you some ideas. So thanks for watching and listening to all of this and getting through it this far. Thanks to Elle for the jack itself. And of course, thanks for letting me be part of this collaboration. It's been great fun. And I look forward to doing another one sometime. Thanks, everybody. I'll see you in the next video. Cheers.